Hi, my name is Barrie and welcome to Live Well With Barrie. A special show this year, Chinese New Year. And I have on my wonderful Chinese New Year t-shirts sent to me directly from Hong Kong, specifically for the occasion. I don't know what it says, but apart from Hong Kong. But anyway, happy Chinese New Year to you all. This week we have a wonderful show with two amazing guests, legends, gentlemen of vintage, Leon and Fitzroy. They will be joining us soon. Right, so this week now we have another guest, legend, that is Mr. Leon Herbert. Now, I mean, he's a legend. I mean, I don't even know where to start. He's somebody that we were looking up to from as early as I can remember in the club scene. Dancer, stylist, entrepreneur, everything. Welcome, mister.
Welcome.
It's great to have you. Thank you for having me. It's my honor to have people of this vintage here. So you've just shouted up.
Vintage.
Vintage is good. Vintage is a very good word.
No, vintage is a very good word.
Vintage.
We're sellable.
A vintage wine.
Indeed.
Quality.
Mature.
Quality. Exactly.
Okay.
Sub quality.
I got that. I got that. So let me know what the vintage is.
No, I'm joking.
So, tell me the journey from where you started to where you are now.
What part of the journey? Well, it's such a varied journey.
Yeah. Let's start from the dancing, to the fashion, to the movie making, We've got a lot of talking to do.
What did he tell you? Did he tell you I smash him up all the time?
Yeah, that's right.
Say I can take him down now?
How do I start?
Yeah? But what happened was, a friend of mine, I used to know, a Greek guy, took me to a place called Trafalgar in King's Road. And that's basically how it all began. I went to Trafalgar in King's Road and I started dancing. And I was too young. And the guy almost didn't let me in the first time I went there. Then I started dancing and he noticed I was getting a lot of the attention from all the women. And there were some other bigger boys there. You know, and one of them was a guy, was Don Betts. You know, I've heard of Don Betts, his brother.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And all of a sudden, I found another set of people that wanted to look after me. So they were like, look at this little boy. So they dragged me over, because there was only five black guys in Chicago. So they dragged me and said, who are you? Then my friend knew them, and they were all starting to be pally with me. And each week they said, this is the guy that seems to get all the girls. We're going to stick with him. And then they started taking me to parties, taking me everywhere. And I remember when I was younger, there was a funny incident where I'd go to parties and they'd pick up some girls and they'd take them back to their houses, or the girls would take them back to their flats. And I'd be sitting like this, waiting for them to do their thing so I can get a ride home. And the girls would be on me and I'm like, I'm young, I'm the same. Obviously I didn't fancy them. And they wouldn't leave me alone. Getting into this kind of groove, you know what I mean? And there's a friend of mine at the time that I'd met was only 16, and his name was Whylie.
Whylie, yeah.
And he used to be really funky, dressed really well. He was really, well, you know, really cool the way he used to dress. And the type of clothes, he used to get all his clothes from Sterling Cooper. And toppers. I couldn't afford it. I was a little boy with no money. But what I could afford was vintage.
I thought you didn't like that word.
Yeah, I didn't like that word. There it comes again. Yeah, I started I'm kind of trying to get to the story really quickly in a kind of very cohesive way. I started going to Lawrence Corner and buying a little bit here because I could use anything I could afford. And then he took me.
That's the surplus store, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And he one day, while he took me to Ronnie Scott's. And one of the strangest things about going to Ronnie Scott's is there was a guy called Desmond. And
he was Desmond Parks.
No.
Trust me.
There's a guy, another guy called Desmond. And he was the king of Ronnie Scott's.
Okay.
On the dance floor. There was nobody.
Desmond.
And Desmond, I used to go to a club much, way before I was still very young, which a friend of mine's brother used to take me to, which was called, what was it called again? I don't remember the name of the place. It'll come to me in a second. It was a funk club. It was just in Chalk Farm.
What, Chalk Farm? Are you talking about Birds This Water?
No,
Birds This.
Chalk Farm? No, it'll come to me. It'll come. Anyway, my friend used to take me there, and Desmond was the king of that place. Yes. So when I went to Ronnie Scott's, I went, I remember that guy. And the place was called Bluesville.
Yeah. All right, I know Bluesville.
Yeah, right. Then I said, I remember him. He's the guy that used to dance so well there. So you've got to understand, I had a friend of mine. Brother, he was really cool looking, very handsome guy, tall. He was from Guyana, but he was long hair, so he used to look like super white.
Skinny guy.
Yeah.
You might know skinny, him. Yeah.
You know Nairman?
Yeah.
His brother.
As you can see, this is a personal catch-up.
Nairman's brother used to take me out.
Right, I know.
And he taught me to do pinwheel. Taught me to do the pinwheel, and he used to do it. He was the Niren's brother was the king of Bluesville.
Mm-hmm.
Desmond was his. And he used to try and
battle
him all the time, and he taught me to do the pinwheel. So when I learned the pinwheel, like Niren's brother. So I was good at it. So, and as time went on, my funk stuff was getting good. So when I arrived in Ronnie Scott's, it was like, I was overwhelmed. It was like, because this is about around the time where music was all you had. You had nothing else because you couldn't buy the records. The only place you could go to hear these records was
in those clubs, yeah.
So, but when I first went to Ronnie Scott's, I couldn't get in. Too young. I don't know if people like you and I mean, if I take my beard off, I'm Babyface.
Yeah.
Still my baby face. And one of my nicknames was Babyface. So the guy didn't let me in. And Whylie, I went there the next week and he talked him into it. And in the end, the guy that was at the door became a good friend of mine. I can't even think of his name, but Senti, was it Senti? I think they met somewhere. And he died since then. But I would then go inside the club and I thought, wow, it's amazing. And then I started dropping the penguin.
Dropping the penguin?
Yeah, no, by that time there was all kinds of
things. That's funny.
And I was dropping some legs, moving around. I saw Desmond, and Desmond was so, it was a stage in Ronnie Scott's. And he had his little crew
and
you could not go. You couldn't even go on that stage. Everywhere he was, where the seats were. I couldn't even, if you went there, they would just push you back. And I used to look at him, and I don't know what it was, because at the time, the only thing I could do was dance.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to think to myself, I'm going to take this guy out. I'm going to tell him. Not in an aggressive way, just...
Dance-wise.
Yeah.
That's what we do.
You call the band. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to deal with you. I don't know how I'm going to deal with you, because I could move. But what I used to do when I used to go on the dance floor, when I used to watch him, and all the crowds, and they I would go on to dance. I was quite shy, but when I came to dancing, I would dance. It didn't matter to me. But it's almost as though he didn't want me to be on the dance floor. Because he wanted all the attention on him. Nothing bad. In the end, we became great friends, and so it doesn't matter. But anyway. Place for some brown. And my life changed. My whole life changed. In the sombrero, I met a guy called Ronnie. And Ronnie could dress like very
little.
And he could dance. And when I'm sitting in the place, I'm looking. What is this dance that you're doing? And I remember for the first time I heard Barrie White. Remember, all we're hearing is funk.
Mm-hmm.
Funk. And all of a sudden I'm hearing Philly music, which at the time I didn't know what it was. I thought, Barrie White, who the hell is this? And the music and that little dancing, the way the place is jamming, it's on the dance floor, and the way they're dancing, I'm just looking thinking, whoa, this is amazing. And the way they all dressed was amazing. And I thought, my eyes like opened and I thought, I want to learn to dance like that. And then Ronnie.
So what kind of years were this? What?
This is 70s.
70s.
Yeah. Then Ronnie then, I was with Mark, he knew Mark, and we were all hanging out. And he said, right, we're going shopping. And I went, shopping? What, 6 o'clock in the morning? He said, yeah, we're going shopping down Portway Road. I went, oh, wow, okay. I said, all right, I've got the money. He said, don't worry. Thank you, sir. All right. I went out, I bought two suits, a couple of second-hand pairs of shoes, and a load of shirts, collar shirts. I thought, okay, now I get it. Now I get it. I went home, my mother took in my suits. By this time, remember, I'm now in the sombrero scene, I'm hanging out with Margo, with Mark, with Ronnie. Ronnie wasn't gay. Ronnie, this is a real good story about Ronnie. Ronnie used to buy vintage watches and vintage things for Armani. That's what Ronnie was. Well, I didn't know that. And he was also a hairdresser. And his best friend was David Bowie's wife.
Okay.
So I used to hang out with David Bowie's wife and him. So I found a new set of friends. By this time, me and Margo and Don, I was still hanging out with Mark, but now I'm with Ronnie. And Ronnie was a DJ also, and he's playing in the club just in South Kensington. And he could dress really well. Now I'm learning.
Now you see the things that are important here, the music and the dress. Very important.
Yeah. I am now learning about it. And by this time now, I've got some moves. I'm now getting some serious moves. So then I've now gone back into my stuff. And by this time, one day I went in there. I think this is when I took Desmond down.
Mm.
Yeah. I'd learned to do the bump.
Mm.
And the way Sombrero they did the bump was completely different to the way Desmond did it. So in the club, he started doing the bump with everybody crowded around like they usually do. And all of a sudden, I went on a dance floor and I started to do the bump with a girl. And the way that I did it was really quite vigorous. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, I'm on the floor and I'm doing my head and mm-hmm. I'm doing it. It was just kicked off.
Yeah.
By this time, now the crowd is screaming. It's now me and Desmond, and we're now in a real competition. Just really weird. By the time it ended, the crowd was screaming because they've never seen the bump like this before, ever. He shook my hand and went, "That was serious, man." And by now, I'm the king of rosebuds. I met this good DJ. Meanwhile, in between all of this, I'm going to Crackers on the Friday
afternoon.
And guess who's there? He's there.
We were talking about that earlier.
Yeah. And he's at Ronnie Scott's. And this time you guys have started to emerge. And Fitzroy was always going to be all the time. But the thing is, I used to admire the way he used to dance. Every so often we'd have a little battle off. But when I was battling off, I was to do what you're doing. My stuff wasn't like that, so I had to go back to the old moves and start the But in the end, it was more fun because we became friends. And it was almost like, yeah, I'm ready for you. You ready for me tonight? Let's go. And we'll be off, and the crowd will be going wild. By that time, everybody's now looking at him too. So for some crazy reason, because of what I was doing, it was coming back to you. And he was the guy, old Fitzroy, and everyone's talking about him. But anyway. I was there for 2 weeks. I just hanging out, going to the club. He's taking me to some brew, taking me to this club, taking me to this club. And I've got a penny in my pocket. I'm hanging out in Fulham. We're going to this shop. Somebody's giving me a pair of shoes, giving me clothes. And all of a sudden, what had happened was, what made me stay so long, there was a guy that came to Monkbury's one night with his suitcase. And his name was Felix. He was a Spanish guy. Mm-hmm. If I do the dance, you're going to go, Leon, I remember it.
Hey, yes.
Yes, 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 yes! Yes! Thank you,
guys. Yeah, no, every person yes. that you French, French boy!
Yes!
Yes!
Felix came to my office with his suitcase. I said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Claude's friend. DJ." Because Claude was out in the club talking to people and talking about them and Claude said, "What's this?" I'm going to get an impression for the first time. The guy played When the Rain.
Donald Byrd.
And the man went on the dance floor and started dancing. And I never, never will ever forget that moment. And I looked at him and I said, "I am not leaving this guy. Wherever he goes, he ain't never going to be able to shake me. I'm learning that dance." And imagine, and then that's the first time I'm now listening to funky jazz. Remember, I started at funk, James Brown, and you know, all them groups that I played from. Then I ended up with Whymperain. I ended up with Fully Sound. And this is when the Fully Sound came and I'm being the king of Ronnie Scott's. I'm dancing on my, remember at that time, sorry, can I get up? At that time.
It's a must.
Yeah, the dances were small like this. You put you're doing that. Okay. Yeah? All of a sudden now, I'm doing this. I'm dancing on my toes. And as time passed, very briefly, the whole scene began changing when it starts. Everybody wanted to learn the steps. And one of the things, I'm now going to talk about him, for some unknown reason, man, he picked it up. And the man was super obsessed. Mm. He picked it up and picked it up.
Mm.
Not a little bit.
No,
because he then started to add funk on top
of it.
And it's like, what? So it's almost as though it was more. People always think that we were in competition, but it was more respect.
Yeah.
I liked it. I wasn't really competitive.
Yeah.
No, I was never competitive. I used to.
Because you're just looking at these people and you're impressed by them and want to learn what they're doing. And
he's taken this, turned it into something else, and all of a sudden we're dancing together and having a whole heap of fun.
Yeah.
And enjoying it, and everybody's like,
but it's a battle of is fun because at the end of the day we walk out of there, we could shake hand, hold up.
Yeah, we were having loving every minute of it.
Even calling out saying, where are you gonna be at weekend?
We're gonna go out again. No, and it was just pure fun. But when I met Felix was now staying in Corbett, I thought to myself, me and him. He taught me how to do the dance. Felix used to sort of play the dance. If there was a music, he'd be like this.
Yeah, yeah.
He was pretty light on his feet. And when I talked about Ronnie, Ronnie would be like that. Where Felix was.
It's more of a flicker foot, yeah.
Really looked like almost dainty on his feet. And he used to wear cowboy boots and cowboy hat. And I realised, hold on a minute, I need to wear a cowboy hat. I've got to get some cowboy boots. Was
and like at the heel.
Was like this.
Yeah.
So it allowed you to go here. So it felt like you're floating on your.
Yeah, let me give you some room here.
No, so with doing this, the reason why you're here because the boots
cut in. Like yeah,
and I thought, that's why he looks like that.
Yeah.
So that was it. I mastered it, and then I took him to run his boots. The whole club just used to go.
Yeah, he was.
Who is this French? Who is he? And by that time, I wouldn't embarrass myself. I could do it.
Mm.
I could do the move. So we used to do it together. By this time, even though I've got Ronnie Scott's, I'm kind of easy now. Because the singing is, my singing is changing. I'm kind of gone slightly out of it. I'm going to sort of really funky clubs.
Mm.
I'm kind of growing up. By this time, I'm 20. I'm now, it's almost as though I could go into Ronnie Scott's and just do this and watch and enjoy him dancing. And it was
time. When you say that, but I actually remember you and Trevor doing exactly that at the WAG watching us.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, we were 6 years, you know?
Because by this time, what you got to remember, as strange as it may seem, and I can say this today with complete fact, people were doing their moves. And there was a few people, like Fitzroy, that were unique in their way. But there was the others that used to follow all the moves. But he somehow had the balance of the two. And that's what you did.
Mm.
So, if I went into Ronnie Scott, I would jump on the dance floor and warm him up a little bit. So he's off. And when he had done that, I just. And enjoy. Because there's one kind of respect that we all had was you respect when somebody's
doing something well.
For instance, there's another friend of ours called Travis. Another part of the story.
Yeah, Travis is a good dancer. Travis is a good dancer.
Of course. I'll be really honest with you. When I met Travis, I met him back way before Sombrero and those days. One night I went to a party I met this guy called Travis. This guy really things, man. And we were having it out. We were on each other. Because I could move too at that time. And that kind of dance. But Travis was very similar to you.
Mm.
And he used to do... I couldn't do what he does. And in the end, as time went on, I began to respect what he did. And I'll tell you something in a second. So here we are now. Fitzroy is running Scots, he's tearing up the dance floor, and then came Trevor. By this time, I've kind of eased out just a little bit. Really, because by this time, I'm kind of moving on in my life. I'm getting older. And Trevor, if Trevor was sitting on the block, because Trevor has a story.
We'll have him here one day.
No, you will. Now, Trevor was trying to find me one day. Right? Because I bumped into Trevor one day. In a club. It was in Union Town, just up in, I told you I used to live in this area, just in the Oval. It was literally a corner of the Oval. It was kind of like, kind of a gateway, mixed. And at the time, I used to go around with 8 girls. And because of that, I used to go girls, used to go. I do 8 girls on the front, we all went out together. And we went to Union Town. And to my surprise, I started to hear that it was this guy trading me down, looking for me to take me on. Desmond Park. Trevor. Who is this guy? I've never met him before in my life. Anyway, I'm now in Union Tavern, sitting there like this with all the girls, and I see this guy on the dance floor. And for a moment, I thought I was having a heart attack. I thought, that man looks just like me. When I dance, why does he look like me? Why am I looking at myself?
Mm-hmm. Now you're finding out where the story begins.
It just completely freaked me out. So I went up to him, I said, who are you? And he was with a girl called Brick.
Okay, yeah.
And then his brother Mike plays with Boy George. Right? Who is this? So I said, what's your name? He said, Trevor. I said, you dance the same as me, sure. So I got up and I started dancing. I thought, wow. And we would, doing some moves. But obviously I had about 10 other moves. This is just the way, because by this time, I'm ingrained in all the moves and all the game I do. Right? I've got a lot of moves from my friend Ronnie. I've got loads of moves. So whatever I pull out, it's going to mess you up. Because you're 18. But by this time now, I started befriending him and we started talking. Anyway, one day I'm going to Shepherd's Bush. I had a girlfriend in Shepherd's Bush. And I see this guy getting off the train. I went, hey, I remember you. We stood at Shepherd Bush Station underneath the tunnel, 3 hours to it.
Fantastic.
Talking about moves, talking about dancing, telling me that I was trading you, I was trying to take you out, but my friend Desmond, and blah, blah, blah. Then, anyway, he found me.
So we've been planning looking for you for ages. What happened to you, man?
I thought he was supposed to be showing me some stuff. And in the end, he stayed in the club also. And then I said to him, and if he was hearing that, because I was speaking to him just an hour ago, I said, you've got to start moving like you, not like me, like you. You've got to find your flavor, not my flavor. And we talked for hours and hours and hours and hours. And he understood. By this time, he got to meet Felix, because he then was interested in being DJ. So Claude to him was the king. His father was the number one DJ. Felix was the DJ in Club 7 in Paris. So Trevor's now in heaven. Music, records, DJing, being around a set of people. But now it's two of us. Imagine, we are now spending our lives every day having a culture club, hanging out.
So now let's go forward a few years to when I was meeting you, like 1984, 85.
Right. Okay, right, okay. To jump.
In the WAG, because that's where I know you. WAG, Café de Paris.
Yeah, right, now.
Embassy.
Yeah.
Now. That's where I know you
change
from.
Change what happened by this time, right? Trevor was now the DJ in Montreux. By that time, that's when you guys were. Because what we had done then, we'd opened the doors for
everybody
to come in now. And the place was now the place, yeah? And I had another friend called Jeff, he was working in Embassy, right? And yeah, there was the WAG. Now, by this time, Trevor and I are the kings of rock and roll, right? Every club we go to,
so that's like around 1984, I would say. Because that's where I remember you doing exactly what you just demonstrated there, coming in and standing up and watching us tearing down over there.
Yeah, and actually enjoying.
Just like this.
Enjoying it. Do you know, one of the things that people never understood about me, I still enjoy watching people dance. I still do. If someone's really, really good, and the reason why I'm going to pick this up when you said the WAG, right? We used to have this thing, I don't know if you, I'm sure you was the same at that time, right? You go on the dance floor and you're dancing with somebody. And at that time, when you're dancing with that person, you realize that person is on it.
Mm.
And there's nothing that you're going to do that's going to make an inch on that person today.
Mm.
He's on his groove today. Tomorrow, maybe not. But today, and when you see that person on their groove, I step off the dance. Because there's nothing, he's
in a zone.
He's in a zone, like the music and him have become one.
Yeah.
And I would just sit there and enjoy and watch. And when they finish, I'd say, that's amazing. And I remember Travis was like that. When we always used to go out and Travis was in his zone, I'd just sit down and enjoy myself. Because, man, I'm not even going to do that.
Attend it.
Do you remember?
Because I'm not going to be. I'm not saying I'm in a competition, but I can't. I am not in tune with the music as much as he is.
As he is, where he is. It's taken him to this place. Yeah.
He's dancing in the air somewhere.
Did you see when he used to do his roller skates?
You do know
Marcy. I do. Yeah.
She's a very tall black girl, yeah. And she can dance. We would dance with her, and you could never take her.
Marcy.
Because she could dance. Yeah. Anyway, she said to me, she woke me up one morning. She said, "We need to come to an audition." I said, "I'm going to go to an audition in Paris and Mahalo. Are you for real?" "I'm not doing anything." She grabbed me and made me to Mahalo. Forced me. I got to the audition, and the person said, "Well, yeah, man, what am I doing here?" Anyway, the guy said to me, "Could you do these steps? You know, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6." I'm thinking, I can't count. I've never done this before. But what I can do, I'm a very good mimic. I can. Do you show me something to mimic you? And that's what I did. I mimicked. Couldn't count. She went, "Oh no, whoa, I got a job." Before I knew it, the very next day, I'm in rehearsals going off to Berlin, thinking, "What am I doing?
How did this happen?
Just like that."
Yeah.
And guess what? I didn't have a passport. Guess what? I had to use Mike's passport. Mike looked similar to me. I used his passport to go to Berlin. I just about to.
We had a police car in the background.
So I used this passport to go to Berlin. I made about maybe 600 quid. Less, maybe more, I don't know if I remember. I think I made a lot more than that. Got back to Paris, gave him £300, they said it was going to be. So it was money for the holiday. Mm. So we went to Milan, went there for 2 or 3 days, came back home. At that time, by this time, what was really kind of happening, Whylie and I were now on the show. We had a vintage. Mm. Yeah, the word vintage.
The word he doesn't like.
We had a vintage shop in Tottenham Court, West Point.
I know this.
So by this time, I was sort of selling clothes. That was what I was doing. I was with him, and we put it together. That's a whole other story on its own. And guess who was upstairs selling main order records?
Oh, what's his name?
Richard Branson.
Richard Branson. Ah.
I knew him really well. And one day when I meet him, I go, I remember you, Richard.
You've done well.
You ain't gonna remember me, but I remember you. And I tell you, he's gonna go, oh, bloody hell. Because I used to drive him nuts. I used to go, Richard, what happened to that? I ordered some stuff and it ain't come. Could you sort it out for me, please? And he said, Leon, could you just leave me alone and ask the guys upstairs? Because I'm not the one doing that. It's them that does it. So, and we used to have this row all the time, every day. But he used to buy clothes for me.
Okay.
So we knew each other. I see him literally every single day of the week. We'd always make money because, you know, our life is in clubs. So we'd go there. And the thing that used to happen, we could dress too. So it wasn't just, remember, we're looking sharp as a pin in some funky clothes. And then we can dance. And before the end of the evening, I would come up to say, oh, can you come and dance for us in that club? And before you say, yeah, at the time, you know.
I mean, you guys were definitely the trailblazers because we then later were doing Christine Pierce.
You see it now?
So, you know, the Delroy Dyers and and myself. Yes, that's right. He went and then I came out. He brought me.
Yeah, because I bought Delroy. Trevor bought Delroy.
That's right.
He was my little prodigy. Mm-hmm. So I brought him on and said, there's no boy like us.
Yeah.
So she started employing. We used to bring people to her. And then by this time, I had not said easing out. I was kind of easing out. By this time, I'd done 9 years of it. So here is an example. I'm going to use one example. Right? And I'm about to do something with my brand, with this one. You'll know. One day, we were in Paris doing a show, and this comic tells us this club called the Bandouche.
Ha! Huh? Paris, yes. Oh, great.
Yeah. So we got there. It was one of those moments of sombrero. We walked into this club. It was in a bathhouse. And I stood there and I thought I was lost in time. I was in a time loop. And this was the 60s. And everybody was doing the whole club. Trevor and I stood there and went, what the hell is this? I looked at him and said, no, we're learning this movement. So we started trying to pick it up, and the track we were dancing to that really stayed in our mind was a track called Planetaire by B52. So, we learned to move, we were practicing it, we were trying to walk the album, and we're in the hotel room. We all this nuts going out, we're being nuts with the move. We didn't do it in the show, we, you know, there's certain moves, you know what? That ain't for them, mate. This is ours. We'll do that another time, but not now. There's three things I'm going to talk about in this, right? There's three moves.
really significant, and you're going to remember every single one of them. We got the move, and the way they dressed, we went around in Paris, we bought some pointed boots, we bought, 1950 ski pants.
Yeah. I remember it all. I remember
this
it.
Is where it started.
Yeah.
A ski jumper. That night, Trevor got back into Mumbai, got back into London. What was that? Yes, it rocks the most. Tonight! So Trevor dropped the tune in the middle of the club at the highest time. Yeah. Right? Everyone went, what the hell is this dude? Almost like one of the stone Trevor. Trevor grabbed the dance floor. And we're like, and the club's like, oh, I get it. And the way we're dressed, it all kind of went together. The very next week, man, everybody is looking for the look. 4 months later, it's on the entire whole Oxford Street. Ski pants, ski jumpers, we brought the whole thing into London. And we were, Trevor said, I've got this new tune that's called Rotation.
Yeah, Herb Alpert. Yeah.
I said, what's that tune? I said, yeah, put it on. I said, look. And we were standing there, and I started going like this. And I started playing tennis. And we were going, both of us were now going
in slow motion.
Like this. Like we were playing. We were really playing table tennis. We just was making it up. And we, by this time, we're so fluid there that we had it down to a fine art. We were doing it for hours and hours and hours, practicing for hours in the room. That's what we always did. We used to dance at a fucking street, we'd dance on the station, it didn't matter where. We had something in our heads, we're doing
it. Yeah. I did that.
Yeah, exactly. So, at the end, we started, we chose the man, got a bit of an headache. We need to get some headaches. So we did this. We went down the stairs like this. Slowly walking into a slow motion. The woman in the hotel thought she was having a heart attack. She completely freaked out. We went in the shop next door, in the chemist, and we went, and the girl took the money like this. And we laughed. Be really honest, thinking to us as people of colour, you know, our lives, as much as we've done, and we created a whole scene amongst, just not me and myself, I was just part of a big scene. And we created all that, but we never got any recognition or recognition.
Recognition more than anything.
We did. No one ever paid attention, but we changed the entire scene. And the young people of today, right, they don't know this. Because once somebody came up to me and I was talking about back in the day, talking about you, you know, dancing. I think I mentioned your name somewhere, I didn't even know. And I said, all those years, this is what we were. We created the scene. So you, man, you today can be who you are, I said to the young guy. And the young guy said to me, do you know what, man? I would like to do something with you talking to young people about back in the day and how talking about your life and talking about almost to inspire.
Yeah, mentoring.
To even today, I mean, today, apart from me, I'm an actor now and I'm just saying it for you. And I have a clothing brand called Mr. Herbert. This is part of my trousers. And And this is part of what I was saying, but the guy said you should go and talk to some younger people, because we, my brand sort of thing is 60 being the new 30. Yeah. So here we are at 60. I will tell you now, if you put on a tune, that's sweet plus both, we'll get up and we'll just start
breaking.
And still, we'll relive some of those moments just immediately, just like that. Because one day I was doing something with my brand, and I did it with Trevor. And I've got a video, I'm sure you're going to play it in this at some point. Not now, but when you put it together, when I'm about to launch. And we were doing a move. When you see the move, you're going, I'm going to show it to you when this is over. And we hadn't danced together for 30 years, no one realizes. When you see us dancing, you think we were dancing this way. It just came.
Came straight back.
Straight back. Without even thinking about it. And at times, I used to have a space in Hackney Wick to create. And I remember there were some young boys in there trying to link them. Every so often, I used to go, oh, really? Okay. And I'm saying, because all the young boys hate this. And I used to get on the dance floor with them. They're about 19, 20, and I used to just, and they say, you're an OG. And they can't believe I could move. They used to be really shocked that I could actually move, and I can still move today.
Good.
I can still go out and dance all night long, still the same. If the music is good, once I'm in the groove, I'm off. And I'm sure you're exactly the same. And you can't help it. It's in our bones. We're not the like our parents.
Oh, absolutely not.
50, 60 is not like
our 50 or 60, definitely not.
We're 60, we're 30 still. If we're still alive and you still can walk, and the difference is we're body awareness. Because you are I am. I don't need meat anymore. I gave that lunch to them.
Well, my producer is telling me to shut my voice down.
Okay, cool.
Okay, Fitzroy, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Amazing having you. I'm Mr. Legend. Oh, that is Leon Herbert. Yeah. Tell me, what are your parting words for our audience of inspiration and encouragement?
Is always believe in who you are. Be who you are. And one of the things I said to my own son, the only gift that I can give you for myself is never give up.
And you are the living testament to that as well, because
no matter how things are getting to you, don't ever give up.
Persevere.
You are the God of your own kingdom.
Lovely. Well, thank you guys. Thank you for joining us. And see you next time.
See you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.